1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. This can't be good for the environment. Put your hand up if you ditched using plastic straws in the past couple of years and instead bought one of these. If you did, you're not alone. In 2018, as straw bans passed across the country, searches for metal straws on Etsy went up 208%, and reusable straw companies sold out. This massive movement away from single-use plastic straws to reusables may have made you feel like you were doing something great for the environment. But did this movement really help, or did ditching plastic straws actually do more harm than good? Find out, I'm gonna speak to Takunda Chitaka. She's researched the environmental impacts of making straws from different materials.
Years ago, we had the mining industry on the chopping block, and now we can't just pretend that doesn't exist because we want to save the marine life.
Then I'll connect with Emy Kane, one of the creators of the hashtag Stop Sucking campaign that has helped pass straw bans across the US.
We've seen policy change in over 100 different cities and countries and in states across the world and across more than 160 large and influential corporations.
I'm Lucy Biggers, and this is One Small Step. The year was 2018, and all of a sudden, everyone was talking about straws.
Doesn't really look like a public enemy.
It's one of the most divisive.
Paper straws are evil.
Most controversial issues in America today.
Just create this black market of straws, big straw, and I can be like the El Chapo of big straw.
As a sustainability video producer at the time, I made several videos about restaurants and cities that had banned plastic straws. I even posted on my Instagram why you should stop sucking.
Here's why you should avoid plastic straws.
At the time, the logic was simple. We're using way too much single-use plastic, and much of it's ending up in our oceans. Like this video that went viral of a straw being pulled out of a turtle's nose. So cutting out straws was the first step in solving plastic ocean pollution. As years have gone by, I've learned a lot. Like the fact that 8 million tons of plastic enter our oceans each year, and straws account for about 0.025% of that. Or the fact that many people with disabilities require plastic straws to drink or eat. And while I still think refusing single-use plastic is a great first step in lowering your environmental footprint, I didn't anticipate this idea of using less would be overtaken by the rise in reusable straws, which is why I now have 9 of them. And literally, I bought none of them, okay? I'm a sustainability producer. People send them to me as gifts. To understand the environmental impact of straw alternatives, I've reached out to PhD student Takunda Chitaka. She literally did her thesis on the environmental footprint of different kinds of straws.
Everywhere I went, there was someone offering me a straw of different types and claiming it's so environmentally friendly. And I was like, I don't really believe you. And I don't think that phrase means what you think it means. So I was like, you know what? I'm going to unpack it. I'm actually going to find out what the impact is of all these straws to see whether we're actually moving forward in terms of our environmental impact or we're going backwards.
In her paper, In Pursuit of Environmentally Friendly Straws, Takunda did a life cycle assessment of 5 kinds of straw materials in her home country of South Africa. Single-use plastic, glass, metal, paper, and PLA, which is a kind of plastic derived from corn that's supposed to be biodegradable, but only breaks down in certain conditions. I did a whole video about it that you can check out.
I went through a process of a life cycle assessment, which is when you look at the impacts from the very beginning, so extracting your raw materials, processing it, to the very end where you throw this item away or recycle it.
Takunda found that metal straws were less likely to be littered and end up in the ocean. But because of the environmental impacts of mining, refining, and shipping, a metal straw would have to be used 37 times for its impact to be less than using plastic straws.
So that's what we call, you know, the break-even point. So you might as well use 20 single-use straws if you're not going to use your metal straw enough times.
Using Takunda's calculations, in the case of my collection of 9 straws, which I am so proud of, I would have to use them a total of 333 times for them to be equal to plastic straws.
I mean, they're going to become family heirlooms at this stage. Put them in your will. Let your grandkids use these straws.
This break-even idea is an important point because if we think about all the frenzy around metal straws in 2018, my guess is that most people who bought those straws have not used them 37 times. My friends and family, many have lost them, forgotten about them, have gone back to using single-use plastic.
Reusable versus single-use depends on your lifestyle. If you are responsible enough to make sure you carry your straw everywhere you go, you know, always remember to bring it out whenever you need it, then reusable is a lifestyle for you. But let's say you're someone who doesn't use straws often, you know, use them for that odd cocktail with the girls once a month. If you look at the number of straws you're going to use an entire year, you might find that it actually has a lower impact than buying a reusable one. So you need to look at your lifestyle and how much straw use plays into that.
Takunda found that glass straws were more sustainable than metal and only had to be used 23 times to break even with plastic. But she also addressed the issue that glass breaks, adding further complications to these comparisons. She found that paper was more sustainable than single-use plastic and PLA. That's because it's less resource-intensive to create and it's more likely to biodegrade if it reaches the ocean. But if the straw is really flimsy, which we've all experienced at some point, using more than one straw defeats the purpose.
I had a situation, I went out, you know, and I had a cocktail evening with my friend, and the waitress brought me a straw. Like, a few minutes later, the straw is just gone. There's just no straw to speak of. It's not happening. She comes back with a plate of straws. You know, this waitress gave me like a plate of 5 straws, and she's like, we've been getting complaints. Trust me, you'll need them. At that stage, if I'm using 5 paper straws to drink one drink, that's not doing any good. I might as well use a plastic straw and make sure it goes to landfill so it doesn't kill the turtles. The quality also matters.
And also, if you're using that single-use plastic, like you said, and it's going to landfill because you live in a place where you're not littering it yourself in a city with good waste management, the chances of that plastic straw ending up in a turtle's nose is almost zero.
Absolutely.
Takunda's research also found that PLA plastic made from corn is sold as compostable or biodegradable, but that its marine biodegradability hasn't been proven.
When I was interacting with the restaurateurs, they actually told me that they were being marketed to them as biodegradable. And as a restaurateur, you're like, this is great, but customers are going to love it. And they're going to market them biodegradable, not knowing that the person who claimed this was not being truthful. So in that case, we found cases of inadvertent greenwashing. They don't mean to, but it happens because they're being fed bad information.
Do you think that plastic and the way that it's talked about right now in public discourse is unfairly vilifying this material, or is the criticism of plastic legitimate?
We have to accept the good with the bad. I always say I'm not pro-plastic, I'm not anti-plastic. I just think we need to be more realistic and responsible when it comes to plastic.
Dozens of cities and organizations have put some ban on plastic straws. I was curious what Takunda thought of these laws.
When you're creating a ban, are you creating a ban that is specific to your region? Or are you creating a ban based on what you've seen online, based on, you know, you've seen the river of bottles in Indonesia? If you then live in a country, say South Africa, we have a high bottle recycling rate. If the government now decided to ban bottles because they saw a photo of a river filled with bottles in Indonesia, that's not fit for purpose. So the first thing you need to understand when you're making a ban, is that item a problem in your country? Or do you just see on social media and you want to feel like you're doing something? Another thing about these bans is, what's the alternative? You're creating a ban, but what happens after you have this ban? What is going to fill the gap? Is that item going to actually do good or take us back to the environmental harm?
Emy Kane is a senior director of digital for Lonely Whale, a nonprofit founded by actor Adrian Grenier, which is focused on decreasing plastic pollution by raising awareness, working with corporate partners, and educating young people. Lonely Whale created the viral celebrity-led hashtag Stop Sucking campaign in 2017 that raised the issue of plastic straws and preceded several straw bans in cities and companies across the U.S.
I will stop sucking.
We will all stop sucking.
We will all stop sucking.
If you do.
What do you think were the biggest benefits from this campaign and the biggest changes that have occurred because of it?
So I think the biggest successes of this campaign were probably that we got people talking about plastic in really interesting places. We got people talking about plastic in the boardroom, in airports, places where, again, plastic or climate change weren't really a kind of a water cooler topic.
Can you talk more about that connection between the straw campaigns and climate change awareness? Because I guess I just don't see the direct connection between like not using a plastic straw and climate change. I mean, one is cutting down your waste, but it's not necessarily like lowering carbon emissions.
I think when you look at it, the straw is such almost like a perfect way in. You know, it is that gateway to plastic, but it's also that gateway conversation to understanding what is plastic? Like, what is this consumption? What is this behavior that I'm even, you know, kind of participating in? But I think it's that moment of mindfulness that really brings people kind of to that aha moment and understanding, yes, it is a bigger systemic issue.
And one of the other backlashes that I saw when it first came out was the disabilities community and people having access to plastic straws. Was that something that you were anticipating? And then how did that inform your campaign?
That was an important conversation to be had. So it's truly one that I'm grateful that, you know, we came under fire for that. And we were able to, you know, not only like draw a really strong commitment internally, but also think thoughtfully about like, yeah, what does the intersection of ableism or, you know, disability rights have with the environment? And any policy that is related to single-use plastic straws, we always try to make sure that folks that do require a plastic straw have access. So whether that is, you know, asking for a plastic straw and receiving one without questions asked, or whether that's, you know, a certain number of other sort of kind of, again, like policy reinforcements that are there to protect, you know, the individual. But that is definitely a key kind of driver in any policy change, is making sure that you've got folks within that community actually part of the policy process.
I feel like people going out and buying a ton of metal straws, I was like, well, kind of misses the point. And so I'm curious to know, like, what is your take on that? And did you see any of the responses to the straw ban and go, oh, well, I didn't actually mean that?
I think some of the things that I saw that were a bummer were things that included like policies that allowed bioplastics or, you know, right, so compostable plastics in areas that don't have industrial composting facilities. And you're like, ah, not only does the business likely not understand that they've been greenwashed, now they're also greenwashing their customers. And so, like you said, intent versus impact, it is a bummer to see kind of those intentions misplaced. And then also too, like, you know, outright banning straws or other items that are needed by folks that, you know, require them for accessibility.
Why do you think straws matter as a symbol of this movement that has gotten so much attention over the last few years?
Straws matter because they were kind of that, again, like that kickstarter to the whole conversation around plastic. And I think if perhaps we hadn't offered the everyday person that fun or funny joke that they can make with their family member, then I'm not sure if we'd be having the same kind of conversation today, generally around plastics or climate change. It might still feel too inaccessible for the everyday person. So I think that for that reason alone, straws do matter.
So, the ditching plastic straws do more harm than good. Honestly, when I was preparing for this video, I was leaning toward yes. I'm concerned about access to plastic straws for people with disabilities, and I do think the rise in reusables, it's pretty wasteful. But talking with Emy reminded me that a few years ago, no one was talking about single-use plastic. So although you could argue the straw campaign and some of the reaction to it hasn't been perfect, it did do a good job of bringing the conversation of sustainability and single-use plastic into the public consciousness. And it has created changes. But like anything that goes mainstream, there is going to be misinterpretation. And I think the rise of buying these trendy reusables is not necessarily the best outcome of the straw campaign. Talking with Takunda also taught me a lot, and she studied the impacts of straws in her home country of South Africa. But she stressed to me that the results could be completely different in a different part of the world, depending on if your energy is coming from renewables or coal, if the materials are found locally or imported. It's really an important reminder that there is no one size fits all. These single-use plastic campaigns are so focused on the end of life that they tend to ignore the upstream impacts of production, which we've learned in the case of metal is way worse than plastic. So, here's what you can do. If you're able to, refuse single-use plastic where you can. It's the best way to lower your personal footprint. But stop buying reusable items you're not going to use.
That's all for this episode. Thank you so much for watching. I hope you learned a lot. And let me know in the comments if you think ditching straws was a good or bad idea.